हेलो, टुडे वील कैरी आउट डिस्कशन ऑन सिग्नल फैक्टर रिप्रेजेंटेशन। द टॉपिक्स टू बी डिस्कस टुडे आर द स्वार्ज इनइक्वालिटी, ग्राफिकल रिप्रेजेंटेशन, ग्राम स्मिथ ऑर्थोगोनलाइजेशन प्रोसीड्योर, कन्वर्शन ऑफ द कंटिन्यूअस एडब्ल्यूजीएन चैनल इन टू ए वेक्टर चैनल, स्टैटिस्टिकल कैरेक्टराइजेशन ऑफ द कोरिलेटेड आउटपुट्स। The Schwarz inequality is one of the important mathematical tool which is very much important because it is useful to calculate the signal to noise ratio for digital communication transmission. We know in case of digital communication, we are sending not the continuous message, but we are sending symbols. So when the symbols are sent, we need to receive and verify its magnitude compared to the threshold magnitude which is set by the transmitter. Because for each of the symbol, an electrical equivalent signal must have a magnitude. So when it is received, it should be compared with a certain limiting value, which is known as the threshold magnitude, so that we can predict which symbol has been transmitted. So that is why, in case of digital communication, we can reduce the error to maximum extent compared to the analog system. So here the Schwarz inequality states that if S1 and S2 are two signals, it's a mathematics, they have shown in terms of function, so we will assume the functions are nothing but the signals. So if the signal S1T and S2T are having the relation S2T equal to C times S1T, where C is a constant, any arbitrary constant, then the square of the integration, where the integration is taken on the product of two signals S1T and S2T, so this quantity will be less or equal to the product of the two integrations, where integrations are made on the normalized power of each of the signal. We know the normalized power is explained by the square of the signal itself. So if we integrate the normalized power, we are getting energy. So S1 square T integrated gives the energy for S1T, S2 square T integrated, so that we are getting the energy for S2T. So this is the relation. So product of the two energy must be greater than or equal to the square of the integration of the product of two signals. So S1T and S2T, as it is showing, can be represented in terms of the basis function. We know the basis function are nothing but the representation of the carrier signal in digital communication. So here phi1T and phi2T are the two number of basis function, of which S11, S12, S21, S22 are the coefficients. So using this coefficient and basis function, we can represent the signals S1T and S2T. We already have discussed in earlier slides. So those relations are given here. And also it is showing that to satisfy the Schwarz inequality, our phi1T and phi2T should satisfy the orthonormality condition. That means the product of the basis function, if integrated, must be equal to 1 when the two number of basis function are same. That means the same basis function, if taken product two times, that means square of the basis function integrated gives us value 1. That means the energy of the carrier or basis function should be equal to 1. Similarly, if the basis function are different, that means phi i t, phi j t are two different basis function, then if they are integrated over the time domain, they should result in numeric 0, because the basis functions are orthogonal to each other. So this orthogonal property and the normalized property, if satisfied, then we can say the basis functions are following the orthonormal property. So orthonormal property of the basis function is mandatory to prove the Schwarz inequality for the digital communication system. Now here the graphical representation of the two number of signals are shown in terms of the coefficients. Now, as we already have seen that S1 is having two coefficient, S11 and S12, and S2 is also having two coefficients. So that is why they are represented in terms of matrix. The cosine of the intermediate angle of the two signal can be written as the ratio of the product of the transpose of S1 multiplied by S2 to the product of two norms. That means S1 and S2. These norms are multiplied and taken in the denominator. And therefore, this signal can be straightforward. That means the cosine of the angle can be written as the ratio of the integration of the product of s1t and s2t to the product of two number of magnitudes, because we have taken the square root of the power. Square root of the power integrated. That means the energy, if taken squared, a square root, then it gives us the magnitude. The Gram-Smith orthogonalization procedure is the mathematical tool which is used for graphical representation of the signal over the axis when the axis is represented by the basis function. Now, this mathematics is very much important, because until and unless we are representing the symbols graphically on the basis function axis, then it is not clear that what is the amount of noise which may contaminate a particular symbol, and the resultant magnitude will be what. That means the calculation of the resultant of the received signal is very much dependent on the amount of noise induced to the transmitted signal. And such mathematical calculation will be simplified if we follow the Gram-Smith orthogonalization procedure. So under this Gram-Smith orthogonalization procedure, we have considered that m number of energy signals are generated, that means s1t, s2t, up to smt, depending on m number of symbols. Therefore, s1t, which is chosen depending on the basis function phi 1t, then the relation of phi 1t with s1t will be given as phi 1t equal to s1t by square root e1. Now, the requirement of such assumption of phi 1t in terms of s1t is important, because we already have seen that our basis function should be normalized as well as orthogonal. Now, orthogonal means the product, if integrated, should be equal to 0, that we know, but equal to 1, that is the square of the basis function, if integrated equal to 1, means it should have the quantity of energy is normalized to 1. So, to satisfy that condition, we have considered phi 1t equal to s1t by square root e1. So, from this equation, we can write s1t is equal to square root e1 multiplied by phi 1t. Now, what is square root e1? It is nothing but the coefficient, first coefficient for s1t, which is s11. We already have seen from earlier calculations. And what is s21? S21 can be written as the integration of the product of s2 and phi 1. Because we already have seen how s11 could be calculated, which is the product of s1t and phi 1t integrated. So, that is why s21 can be written similarly with this equation. The Gram-Smith orthogonalization procedure is also carried out by considering an intermediate function, which is shown here, g2t, is equal to the difference of s2t and the product s21 with phi 1. Now, phi 2t, similar to the phi 1t, we can write as it is the ratio of the g2t and the square root of the integration of the square of the g2t. Because we already have seen phi 1t was written as the ratio of the signal to the square root of energy. So, similarly, here is also phi 2t can be written, because we have considered g2t as the intermediate signal. And phi 2t is further simplified by substitution of the previous equations by the second equation. And we must not forget that phi 2t is also satisfying the orthonormalized function property. That means the square of phi 2, if integrated, should be equal to 1. And if we take the integration of the product of phi 1 and phi 2, that is also equal to 0. The mathematics is also carried out to find out the generalized expression of the intermediate function git, which is the difference between the sit and the algebraic sum of the product of the coefficient and the basis function. So, here from we can easily write out that the coefficients are nothing but the integration of the product of the signal and the basis function. This is the condition for which we can write the intermediate function expression, which is written at the top. Therefore, the basis function in general, what we can write, it is the ratio of the intermediate function to the square root of the energy of the intermediate function. So, energy of the intermediate function means It is the integration of the square of the intermediate fraction. So which form on orthogonal which is a form in orthogonal set, the dimension n is less or equal to the number of given signals m depending on one of the two possibilities. That means for the signals s1t, s2t up to smt form a linearly independent set in which n equal to m, that means the number of basis functions should be equal to the number of symbols, and the signals s1t, s2t up to smt are not linearly independent, in which case capital N is less or equal to m because the number of basis function will be less than the number of symbol, and the intermediate functions git is 0 for the l greater than n. The conversion of the continuous AWGN channel into the vector channel is an important conclusion, in which we should start our discussion from the received signal equation, because we know the received signal is always the contaminated version of the transmitted signal. We already have seen that transmitted signal which is passing through the channel is algebraically added with the noise which is generated in the channel, and we know in the channel the type of the noise is white Gaussian because we are considering all the frequency component, and its probability density function is symmetric with respect to the y-axis, where the magnitude of the probability density function is maximum on the y-axis and it is gradually falling on both sides. So that is why it has equal distribution. And if we consider the white noise which is Gaussian in nature, then we are including all sorts of noise, we are not disobeying any particular frequency. So it may happen that in urban sector most of the frequencies are having the contribution of noise, but in case of rural sector some frequencies are having negligible amount of noise. So if we consider in general white Gaussian noise, it is including all types of frequencies for the noise, so that the generalist noise can be applied for any type of calculation, whether it is the urban area or rural area or it is on the ocean surface. So that is why here we are representing all this thing in terms of random process, because a random process is a experiment in which with respect to time we are getting some unpredictable magnitude of the signals in the continuous domain. So xt is the received random process, we can say sit is the transmitted random process from the transmitter, and wt is the unwanted disturbance in terms of random process. So therefore we can here easily write that wt is the sample function of the white Gaussian noise random process of zero mean and power spectral density n 0 by 2. Correspondingly, we find that the output of correlator j say is the sample value of a random variable xj, which is shown by xj equal to integration of the product of xt and phi jt. So it is equal to the algebraic sum of the coefficients and the random variable of white Gaussian noise. So therefore we can write the coefficient Sij as the integration of the product of Sit and phi jt, and also Wj is equal to the integration of the product of Wt and phi jt. Now this Wj is nothing but the random variable for the jth basis function. So how it has been come? We know phi j is nothing but the jth basis function. So if we sample the random process wt, which is the additive white Gaussian noise, then you can easily find out the random variable wj. So wj is nothing but the integration of the product of wt and phi jt. So here from we can express a random process x prime t whose sample function small x prime t is related to the received signal xt. So xt is a random process. So x prime t is equal to xt minus algebraic sum for n number of terms of the product of xj and phi j. So xj is the random variable for the received signal or received random process, and phi j is the jth basis function which is having the orthonormal property. Therefore, we can write the final equation of x prime t, which is nothing but the substitute of previous versions, which is nothing but equal to w prime t. So therefore, the sample function x prime t depends solely on the channel noise w t. On the basis of above equation, we may thus express the received signal as x t equal to j equal to 1 to n, the product of x j phi j plus x prime t. Therefore, x prime t can be replaced by the w prime t. The statistical characterization of the correlator output is very much important because the correlator produces the estimated symbols. That means the receiver output is nothing but the correlator output, which is required to be properly decided by the decision making device. Otherwise, we will have the wrong symbols at the receiving end. So here are some important properties or important parameters which are mentioned in the correlator. That is mu xj, it is the statistical mean of the random variable xj, and the variance sigma x square. So these are important parameters because the statistical mean, if we have this value, that is equal to the coefficients of the transmitted signal, and sigma x square, which is nothing but the expectation of the random variable wj. So these are important relations which are used for the determination of signal to noise ratio at the receiver end. So wj is nothing but the integration of the product of wt and phi j, and the sigma x square can be written as the expectation of the two integrations of the random variable wt sampled at t equal to time t and t equal to at u. So therefore, if we apply the expectation operator inside, then you can take the expectation of the product of wt and wu, which is nothing but the autocorrelation of the white Gaussian noise. Now this autocorrelation of the white Gaussian noise, if we find its expression, as we know, the white Gaussian noise is having some property, probability, density functions, everything is known. So we can take the function of autocorrelation function for the white Gaussian noise as n0 by 2 multiplied by delta t minus u. So n0 is the constant power spectral density for the white Gaussian noise, and the delta function, as we know, at t equal to u, it is having the magnitude 1, otherwise the value is 0. So therefore, the important mathematical derivations are followed. That is, the variance has been calculated here, as well as the variance is equal to constant, which is n0 by 2, and the covariance, which is giving a conclusion regarding the correlation of the two number of random variable of the receiving random variable. So as the covariance of the two number of receiving random variable is 0, therefore it is very much clear that the dependency of the two random variables for the receiving signal are 0. So therefore, two number of receiving signals are independent to each other if they are taken for two different symbols. So as the symbols generated are independent to each other, so receiving symbol should have interdependent nature. Otherwise, the dependency of symbol may be critical for the receiving end estimation. Now the statistical characterization of the correlator output is still carried out for the probability density function, which is the expression of the product of the probability density functions when the receiving symbol xj and the transmitted symbol is mi. That means the I equal to 1 to m for which we have transmitted the symbol, we are calculating the probability density function is nothing but the product of the all probability density functions for j equal to 1 to n. Therefore, the receiving vector can be summarized as the matrix of x1 to xn. The probability density functions of xj, provided that mi has been transmitted, have the general expression is given here.